After spending all of Lent with Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew and the Beatitudes, we wanted to continue our series moving through books of the Bible, but also build towards Pentecost Sunday, when we celebrate the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so we decided to follow the journey of the Holy Spirit through the New Testament. Now we realized in following references to the Holy Spirit that where it shows up in the New Testament is some particular places and situations, like early church communities who were trying to find their way as the body of Christ on earth, in the rushing wind and the tongues of fire in the Gospel of Acts. And that led us, of course, to thinking about the Spirit as we find it in earth, wind, and fire. Now the band Earth, Wind, and Fire itself has been known for some things that seem pretty Holy Spirit in nature. It's known for energy and movement and combining different and interesting vocal arrangement and instrumental choices. Ever since its very first album was released in 1971, Earth, Wind, and Fire has been known for crossing musical boundaries, for blending styles like jazz and R&B and pop and gospel. And many of their songs have a spiritual theme, have titles like Burnin' Bush, Sunday Morning, Spirit of a New World. And in fact, Maurice White, who of course is the founder and the lead singer of Earth, Wind, and Fire, said that when he formed the group, that he was actually trying to create a kind of music that was spiritual in nature, but because it was pop music, was also not going to be overtly religious in what they shared. But part of the appeal of Earth, Wind, and Fire, I think, is also that their songs, while they have a deeper meaning, are also just fun. It's the kind of music that pulls people onto the dance floor. And so in that spirit, I want to show you one of the very important ways that our staff prepared for worship this week and prepared for this series in our online staff Zoom meeting. Take a look. I like to think that's pretty good for early on a Tuesday morning Zoom meeting. Not a bad dance party. Now, we begin this week, of course, with a look at the Spirit in the book of Romans, which is an admittedly full and maybe even intimidating place to start. But it's also a really important one for looking at the work of the Spirit in the New Testament. Romans, of course, is one of Paul's most well-known letters. It's probably written in the late 50s, around 60 CE, during Paul's third missionary journey while he was in Corinth. It was a letter written to Christians who were living in Rome, and unlike the letters to the church at Corinth or Galatia, it isn't really addressing specific social issues or the particular context of their community. Instead, it's trying to communicate some basic theological arguments around central concepts of the Christian faith, like salvation, justification through Christ, righteousness. And Paul is trying to share these with the Christians at Rome to introduce himself and remind them of what it means to be a follower of Christ at this time and living in this multi-faith contemporary context of Rome. Now, chapter 8 of Romans is where Paul really focuses on the work of the Holy Spirit. And the selection that Lucy read for us today highlights some of the key parts that Paul wants us to understand, wants to convey to the Romans. First and foremost, Paul tells us that the Spirit is fundamentally part of God, and it is part of God's saving work. So Paul doesn't use the word Trinity, but we can clearly see that he's describing a relationship between God and Jesus Christ and the Spirit. Now, we will talk more about the Trinity on another Sunday, but it's important as we're beginning this journey following the work of the Spirit that we know that the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Ghost, as some people call it, is the work of God. That it's not some kind of separate force operating in the world, that God's presence and God's power is active in the Holy Spirit, just like we see it active in the work of creation in the book of Genesis, just like we see it in the birth and life and resurrection of Jesus in the Gospels. God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is God. And that Spirit, that Holy Spirit, is a source of freedom. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. The Spirit is meant to be a power that is life-giving, that is saving, that is freeing. Yes, as human beings, we sin, we fail. We're caught up in systems that hurt ourselves, that hurt each other, that hurt the world, even sometimes to the point of death. The Spirit of God is alive. It's at work in each and every one of us to free us, not only in our ability to help shape and guide our choices and to help lead us towards better decisions that are more faithful and more loving, but the Spirit also frees us to believe, to trust that God's grace and the saving work of Jesus Christ isn't dependent on our individual behavior at any one moment in time. We are freed by the power of God's love and by the work of the Spirit to keep letting the Spirit change us, to lead us from death into life every single time we go down that path, as often as it takes, because there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And the new life and the work of the Spirit can continue. That's why it's important to leave room for the Spirit to continue working. It is freeing to let God work in us, to let Christ transform us and to be in us. It brings us into our fullest potential as God's creation. And it's important that we leave space and room for that, that we recognize that and not try to mold and shape God into who we want God to be for us, but recognize how God might be changing and transforming us. In the final verses of this section, verses 26 and 27, Paul talks about the Spirit helping us in our weakness. When we recognize our weakness, our need for God to move around and to change and transform us, the Spirit can do a little house cleaning. Now, we talked a lot about these particular verses in both of my small groups this past week, and what it might mean for the Spirit to intercede for us, especially this idea of interceding in our prayers, when we aren't even sure what to pray for and that the Spirit will intercede with sighs or groans that are too deep for words. I even shared this image with some of the folks from one of my groups. Now, I read these verses as a very hopeful thing, not that we are exhausting to the Spirit of God, and that those are sighs of resignation, like the ones of a weary parent or caregiver who is just done. But instead, as a description of how what we think we need, what we hope for ourselves or for the world, can sometimes be far beyond our ability to comprehend or even to convey. That's why I love that image of the jumble of letters. I've had plenty of experiences of prayer that felt like I began them by saying, God, I don't even know where to start. And frankly, some pain, some weakness, some hurt is too deep for words. What we need is not for someone to explain it away, to convince us why ultimately everything will be okay, or to diminish that pain or that uncertainty. We need a God who knows it, who feels it, who receives it, and who meets us in those places of weakness, who transforms it and leads us to new life. Now, the work of Spirit isn't to pretend that everything is just right with us or with the world. The work of the Spirit is to help us believe that God's salvation is ongoing, that it hasn't stopped, that it's available in us, in the world, surrounding us and filling us. And filling us in. The work of the Spirit and the work of the Spirit in the book of Romans isn't to save us from ourselves or to convince us that our humanity is something to be feared or ashamed of. It's reminding us who God has called us and created us to be at our very best. It is reminding us who God has freed us to be, and how it is that we tap into the power to not be held captive to our greatest weaknesses and even to live beyond what we think of as our greatest strengths. The Spirit calls us beyond our individual anything to a life that is rooted in God and in community, that is joyful and messy and humble and wholeheartedly interwoven with the lives of others. Whether that's in person, in Zoom meetings, in YouTube worship, whether we are 6 feet apart or across the globe, it doesn't really matter. The Spirit can make the leap if we are willing to make ourselves available to what God can do in us and through us and even beyond us. The Spirit can take all the messiness of what we individually think we need and want. It can take all the differences of opinion and culture and politics that divide us. It can take all the particular ways that people have access and resources and the ways that they don't. We've seen that happen even now in the midst of the great pain and suffering that is in the world. We have seen the work of the Spirit bringing people together, calling them beyond their individual needs to a life of community and of hope and humility and service. And if we continue to let the Spirit work in us, it can cross our boundaries. It can overcome our differences. It can even transform us. It can help us to be courageous and faithful and also humble enough to know when we need to pull back from what we think we need and instead give the Spirit some room to do its work. When Allie Willis was still a struggling songwriter living in LA in 1978, she got the call that every person dreams of. It was Maurice White asking her to help co-write Earth, Wind, and Fire's next album. She walked into the studio the next day and they had just finished the intro to the song September. And so over the next month, she worked on that song with them together. And while she loved it, she started to fear a little bit that perhaps the lyrics were a little too simplistic, especially the phrase Badia, which she thought of as pure nonsense. Badia, what? What does that even mean? She kept pressing Maurice White as they were doing their writing. This is just a filler, right? We're gonna fill in with actual words here eventually, right? But sure enough, they got to their final vocal recording session and it became clear that Badia was there to stay. What does it even mean? She begged Maurice White. Who cares? Was essentially his response. And of course, that little nonsense phrase became one of the most famous parts of the most famous song that Earth, Wind, and Fire ever wrote. And that's when she said that she learned her greatest lesson in songwriting. Never let the lyric get in the way of the groove. As we follow the work of the Holy Spirit through all of these early church communities in these coming weeks, as we follow the work of the Spirit in our own lives today, perhaps that is worth remembering, that we might have a lot to say and to do about what God is doing here in the world, but we also need to leave room for the Spirit of freedom and of power and of righteousness to live and to move in us, to take us beyond our human limitations by Christ's love and to let God's renewing power be at work. Sometimes it might feel a little strange to let go and let the Spirit take up more room in us. It will almost certainly push us beyond what we find entirely comfortable. But it's kind of like when you see those people out on the dance floor who have just abandoned themselves to the power of the music and the moment, people who look like they were in the midst of a spiritual experience of some kind. In the light of the hope of Easter, in the light of resurrection faith, let's commit to following the Spirit however and wherever it leads us. And don't be afraid. Don't let our own lyrics get in the way of God's groove. Don't be afraid to follow where the Spirit is leading and calling and freeing us today. Amen.